So thank you, Professor Murthy, for this kind introduction and giving me this opportunity to speak at the Fields Institute number theory seminar. So it's indeed a great pleasure to speak here. So hopefully my internet will hold on and it will be glitch free. But in general also, this is maybe only second or third time I'm attempting a webinar. So anyway, I'm not very confident about the presentation. So please stop me if there is any glitch or any questions. Okay, so we are going to talk about something related to Selmer group. So let me start by the definition of elliptic curve. So, well, elliptic curve is a pair E and O, where E is a smooth projective curve of genus one and O is a point on E. But let's say we are talking about elliptic curve over Q and its Q rational points, then we can simply think it as a solution of some cubic equation. And if you remove one in projective coordinate, and if you remove one particular point, 0, 1, 0, then we can even think about it as an affine coordinate as y square equal to x cube plus ax plus b, where this cubic has three distinct roots, x cube plus ax plus b, this cubic has three distinct roots. So the interesting thing about elliptic curve is that given two points on the elliptic curve, you can add them by a group law and get a third point on the elliptic curve. And the way you add two points on an elliptic curve, P plus Q, let's say, is the same way you add Q plus P. So the group law you will define is abelian. So there is an abelian group law on the, let's say, point of the Q rational points of the elliptic curve. And one of the theorem of model says that EQ is a finitely generated abelian group. In fact, if I take any number field K, then EK is a finitely generated abelian group, which is due to Weyl. So the usual proof of this result in textbooks goes via two steps. So first one, what one proves is a weak model Weyl theorem. So one picks an N, generally N equal to 2, and one proves that EQ mod N times EQ is a finite abelian group, and then uses some height function. So this proof that EQ mod N times EQ is finite uses that the N Selmer group is finite. So we are going to introduce it later. So that's how, even in this basic proof of this theorem, essentially Selmer groups enter into the picture. Okay, so yeah, so this is the L function. So this is the Q rational point of the elliptic curve. On the other hand, there is a fundamental analytic object attached to an elliptic curve, which is the complex L function of the elliptic curve, and it is defined as follows. So you pick a prime P, and you take it's a Dirichlet series defined by this Euler product. So for each P, you have a degree 2 polynomial LPT, and you evaluate it at P to the power minus S, and then you take the reciprocal. And this is for almost all P, so all but finitely many primes, so at good places, this degree 2 polynomial is given by 1 plus P times T square plus APT, where this AP is P plus 1 minus some quantity which is coming from the data of the elliptic curve. So this is the L function of the elliptic curve, and although it is defined on a half plane, so if you complete it, so if you throw in the factors at infinity, so the some gamma function and some power of pi and some power of the conductor, then this completed L function can be actually analytically continued as an entire function to C and satisfy the functional equation of the form. So A little da S is plus minus A little da 2 minus S. So this is called the functional equation of the L function, and we'll use it later again, but this is a rather deep theorem. So first step, we need to know that the elliptic curve comes from an automorphic form, or rather elliptic curve is modular. So this is essentially Weyl's proof of Shimura-Taniyama-Weyl conjecture. So we know that if it is an elliptic curve, then there is a weight 2 new form attached to it. And the L function, one of the way to state modularity is that the L function of the elliptic curve coincides with the L function of the modular form. And result of, so once you know it's the L function of a modular form, then due to Hecke, we know this is essentially this completed L function can be written as Mellin transform of itself. So the L function of the modular form is the Mellin transform, essentially of the Mellin transform of the modular form. And then we can break it into two parts and use the automorphic property, that f of that it is, it has symmetry with respect to congruent subgroup. So using that, this proof can be completed. So this is the functional equation of the complex cell function. So we'll again use this. So, and of course, although we do not directly discuss this, the famous Birch-Schnittendyer conjecture predicts a deep relation between this arithmetic object, Q rational point of the elliptic curve, and analytic object, L function of the elliptic curve. So Iwasawa theory, in some sense, of course, I can see Professor Ginsburg is there, but let me just say Iwasawa theory predicts analog of this, in the periodic analog of this kind of in spirit, which are similar to Birch-Schnittendyer conjecture. So to discuss further, we define what is called the p-infinity Selmer group. So first, let me define that p-Selmer group. So p-Selmer group and elliptic curve is kernel of this following, in some sense, some kind of failure of global to local Galois cohomology groups. So you have the p-torsion point of q-bar rational points of the elliptic curve, and there is action of that absolute Galois group. So you consider the first Galois cohomology, and the absolute Galois group of L-adic numbers is a subgroup of this absolute Galois group of Q. So for each L, you have a restriction map of Galois cohomology, and the kernel of this restriction map is called the p-Selmer group. So here we have product over all prime cell, and this kernel is the p-Selmer group. And similarly, one can define P square Selmer group. If I put P square here, I can define P to the power 3 Selmer group, P to the power n Selmer group. And if I take the limit, then that is the P infinity Selmer group. So this is the P infinity Selmer group. And then one is this fundamental exact sequence that the EQ mod P times EQ injects into. So Selmer group gives an upper bound. This so if you like, the FP rank of this finite dimensional FP vector space gives an upper bound on the model well rank of the elliptic curve. And this thing, unfortunately, is not computable. So for example, only we can compute these things. And so this is used in the proof of model well theorem. And this is a standard way, is a useful way of looking at Selmer group. So not only with P Selmer group, we can do the same thing with P infinity Selmer group. Then we'll have that EQ tensor QP mod ZP injects into the P infinity Selmer group. And the co-kernel is the P primary part of the Shah-Tate-Shefferovich group. And this group is supposed to be finite. So so essentially, then if this group is finite, then this captures this rank. That is the idea, but of course we do not know the finiteness of Tate-Shefferovich group. Notice that here, just to ease the burden of notation, because in this talk we'll be talking about p-infinity Selmer group. So I have dropped this p-infinity. So S p-infinity E over Q, I just denote by S E over Q. Okay. So for example, recently there are a lot of interest in p-Selmer group and p-Selmer group and p-infinity Selmer group of elliptic curve on number field. So there are several works of Bhargava and his collaborator, and there are several works of Mazur Rubin, for example, on p-Selmer group and p-infinity Selmer group on number field. But today, what I'm going to talk about is studying Selmer group from the point of view of Iwasawa theory. So I'm going to talk about some infinite extension of a number field. So So let me introduce that. So there exists a big field extension of Q, so contained inside, adjoining P to the power nth root of unity. So you have a Q, and then you can adjoin. So you fix a prime P, and we adjoin P root of unity, P square root of unity, P to the power nth root of unity. So inside that, there is a big Galois extension of Q, whose Galois group is isomorphic to the periodic integers, and it is denoted by Q cyclotomic. And then we can express it as a tower of number fields Qn. So Q subset of Qn subset of Q cyclotomic, such that Galois group of Qn over Q is isomorphic to Z mod P to the power nZ. So, and one defines the Iwasawa algebra ZP power series gamma, the completed group ring of this Galois group. So in this literature, one uses multiplicative notation, and gamma is just a multiplicative notation of ZP. and gamma n are these cyclic groups of order p to the power n. So you can define the ordinary group ring of a cyclic group of order p to the power n, that is Zp gamma n, and we can take the inverse limit, that is the completed group ring Zp gamma, and this is called the Iwasawa algebra of gamma, and it is isomorphic to non-canonically one can choose a generator and show that it is isomorphic to power series ring over one in one variable over Zp. So and similarly, I define Selmer group over Q, but one can P infinity Selmer group over Q. But go for any number field, one can define P infinity Selmer groups, and taking limit, one can define the Selmer group over Q cyclotomic. So that is a Selmer group of E over Q cyclotomic, and it's a module over this ring. And there's the action of the Galois group on this. One can show there's the action of the Galois group on this, and it is actually a Zp gamma module. And in fact, the standard results of on Galois cohomology says that this is actually, if I so this is a discrete object. If I take the Pontryagin dual, then that is a compact Zp gamma module, and one can show that is a finitely oriented Zp gamma module by standard results on cohomology, Galois cohomology. So now we assume that he has good and ordinary reduction at P. So throughout we make this assumption. So the reduced elliptic curve. Given the elliptic curve over Q, let's say if I look at the elliptic curve over FP, then that remains an elliptic curve that is called good. And let's say that good ordinary means that P doesn't divide the Pth Fourier coefficient of the corresponding modular form. So, so under this assumption, so one can talk about, so in some sense, this is the periodic analog is algebraic periodic object attached to the elliptic curve is P infinity Selmer group or its Pontryagin dual. And there is an analytic periodic object attached to this elliptic curve, which is called periodic L function. So this is so assume E is good ordinary at P, then there exists a power series in the Iwasawa algebra, but under mild condition it is in Iwasawa algebra. But generally, we say it is in ZP Iwasawa algebra tensor QP. And it is main point, it is characterized by this interpolation property that you take any finite order character phi of gamma, then the value of this periodic L function is the value of the algebraic value, special algebraic value of the twisted L function. So you have the L function of the elliptic curve, complex L function of the elliptic curve. Then for every Dirichlet character of order p to the power n, I can define the twisted complex L function LE phi s. And then by dividing appropriate period and so on, the, by result of Shimura, it is an algebraic number. So this phi is varying of order p to the power n. So let's say n is varying. So this phi is varying. So you have infinitely many algebraic values divided by period, some Gauss sum, so that it becomes, you remove the transcendental part and it becomes algebraic. And this is characterized by that it interpolates those algebraic values. And by results of Rolick, it is known to be non-zero. So this is called the periodic L function. So it is a power series, and it can have only finitely many zeros by Weierstrass propagation theorem. So this is uniquely determined by this interpolation property of this interpolation property defined by this special value of the twisted complex L functions. So and this cyclotomic Iwasawa main conjecture of E says that this periodic L function is a generator of this. So this Selmer group, in fact, I said it's a finitely generated, the Pontryagin dual of the Selmer group is a finitely generated ZPT module, but in fact, it's a finitely generated torsion ZPT module. So there is a characteristic ideal one can associate. And what Iwasawa main conjecture says that this characteristic ideal of this is generated by this periodic L function. And now, so characteristic ideal is generated by this periodic L function. So, so this is the Iwasawa main conjecture. And now in many cases, in most cases, one side divisibility was shown by Kato, and another side is now shown by Skinner-Urban. So combining this work of Skinner-Urban and Kato, we know this equality for every almost so for a very large class of elliptic curve, this equality is known now. So now let me go back. So we discussed the functional equation for the complex L function, And now we have this periodical function which interpolates this special algebraic values. So from there one can show this periodical function also satisfies a relation which is of this form, that GET is some unit times G of 1 by 1 plus T minus 1. So in this Iwasawa algebra, this T 1 plus T corresponds to a topological generator of this. Gamma is topologically cyclic because gamma is isomorphic to ZP. So it has a generator, topological generator, you can call it small gamma. So this small gamma corresponds to 1 plus T. So this T 1 by 1 plus T minus 1 corresponds to gamma inverse. So 1 plus T corresponds to gamma. So 1 by 1 plus T corresponds to gamma inverse. So if we have this involution that gamma going to gamma inverse in this Iwasawa algebra, so one can show that using this interpolation property that GE, this periodical function satisfies. So we can call this the functional equation of periodical function. So GET is some unit times GE 1 by 1 plus T minus 1, where U is a unit in ZP gamma. So this, for example, this kind of functional equation, for example, is already discussed in paper of Mazur-Teitelbaum. But anyway, one can achieve this kind of equality. So then we have that this functional equation, if I may call so, of the periodical function. And we have that the periodical function is a generator of the characteristic ideal of the Selmer group. Then I get a functional equation of the characteristic ideal of the Selmer group, which I call algebraic functional equation. And I'm going to say more about this, but this looks like this, that characteristic ideal of the Selmer group and characteristic ideal of the Selmer group. So here there's an iota here. This is a dual Selmer group and the only change is iota. So iota means this involution, gamma going to gamma inverse, which basically means if you know the characteristic ideal of one, then you instead of T, you put this 1 by 1 plus T minus 1. Okay, so this is called the algebraic functional equation. So this was proved by Greenberg and also by Perrin-Ryu, and this can be found in. So in an ideal world, this comes from, this is a reflection of the fact that that the periodical function, the functional equation of the complex L function and the periodical function interpolates the complex L function. It's a reflection of this two fact by Iwasawa main conjecture. But this is a purely algebraic result and this can be proved purely algebraically without inferring to Iwasawa main conjecture or without inferring to existence of periodical function or Iwasawa main conjecture. So this can be proved purely algebraically, and indeed it has been proved by can be found in the article of Greenberg and also Perrin-Ryu. So let me explain briefly how this is proved. So there are I briefly now discuss the proof of this. Okay, so proof is by a few steps. First is what is called a twisting lemma, which says the following. So suppose M is a finitely integrated torsion ZP gamma module, then there exists a continuous character theta from gamma to ZP star, such that the gamma to the power p to the power n covariant, so m theta of gamma p to the power n, so this is just H naught homology of gamma to the power p to the power n m theta. So the largest quotient of m theta on which gamma to the power p to the power n acts trivially. So this is finite for every n, okay? And m theta means m tensor ZP theta, and we apply diagonal action of G. So the usual meaning of twist. So let me give an example. So for example, if you take this module M equal to ZPT by T, then this going co-invariant with respect to gamma to the power P to the power N corresponds to quotient by the ideal 1 plus T to the power P to the power N minus 1. Okay. So if my M is ZP power series T mod T, then this object is infinite for every N. But if I make T to T minus P, if I change T to T minus P, ZPT by T minus P, which corresponds to theta, sending a topological generator of gamma to 1 plus P. If I do that, then this guy becomes finite for every N. So this result is called twisting lemma. So this is the first result which is needed in this. And in fact, the proof of this twisting lemma is that you pick any theta, such that theta times p to the power nth root of unity is not equal to a root of the characteristic polynomial of m plus 1. then that theta will work. You can essentially pick almost any theta, so that theta of the topological generator. So gamma is isomorphic to ZP. So let's say small gamma is a topological generator. So you just make sure the theta of gamma times the root of unity minus one is not equal to root of this characteristic polynomial of n. So any such theta will work. So this is one step. Then second is Mazur's control theorem. So it says that the kernel of co-kernel of kernel and co-kernel of this canonical restriction map, which I denote by r theta n. So you have Selmer group over Qn, and then you have Selmer group over Q cyclotomic, and then you can take its fixed point by gamma raised to n. And the kernel and co-kernel of this are finite. And actually, one needs the twisted version. So I put twist here theta, but without twist, this is originally what is called Mazur's control theorem. So the kernel and co-kernel of this are finite and uniformly bounded. Here, it may be noted that throughout I am keeping this hypothesis that he has good ordinary reduction at P. Ordinary is especially important here. And then we can pick a theta by this twisting lemma, such that the Selmer group twisted by theta is gamma invariant is finite for every n. And then by pairing of flak, we know this Selmer group is isomorphic to, essentially is isomorphic to its Pontryagin dual. Okay, so this is the Castle-Tet pairing, and the final thing which is, so employing this 1, 2, 3 steps, we can get a pairing from the Selmer group, the Pontryagin dual of the Selmer group, now without the twist, to this, what is called the Iwasawa adjoint. So X1 of this Iwasawa algebra of the Selmer group with the iota action, and then again the Iwasawa algebra. We can get a map, and this map is a pseudo-isomorphism in the sense kernel and co-kernel are finite groups. So we can get a map like this, and from there it is easy to see that the characteristic ideal of this is same as the characteristic ideal of this, and this characteristic ideal is same as the characteristic ideal of this. So essentially, this is the proof of this algebraic functional equation. So these are the key steps, that having a pairing by flak, then having a control theorem, and having a twisting lemma. So now if we have this result, so this is over, of course, over cyclotomic ZP extension of Q, but now I can ask this question, that since this is a purely algebraic result, I can ask this question that what if I change the motif? Instead of elliptic curve, if I talk about modular form or some other motif, does this result hold? And why only Q cyclotomic? Can I take other periodically extensions of Q or generally of a number field? Then does this result hold? And this is especially curious in the sense of, so for example, already if I take an arbitrary, let's say non-commutative number field, then for K cyclotomic, this Iwasawa main conjecture maybe is not known. So already then periodical function in this kind of Iwasawa main conjecture, then for example, is not known. Then if I can prove this result algebraically and independently generalizing these steps, then it is interesting. And also, instead of Y cyclotomic, as I said, I can take a general periodically extension. Even bigger extension is Galois group is a compact periodically group. So such kind of extension is what is so-called this non-commutative Iwasawa theory. So, but such kind of extension occurs naturally in arithmetic. So this is the question I'm asking. So are there generalization of this result to other periodical extension, other motifs for algebraic functional equation? And second question I'm asking, to have this result, is the twisting lemma established for a general periodically extension? So why this kind of periodically extension is important or interesting? So just a minute. Yeah, so for example, there is this a result of Serre on Serre's open image theorem. So you take E, a non-CM elliptic curve over Q, then it is well known that that the Galois group of the division point, so you attach all the P torsion point of elliptic curve, P square torsion point of elliptic curve, P to the power n torsion point of elliptic curve, then this big Galois extension you get is is open subgroup of GL to ZP for any prime P. So this is Sayre's open image theorem. So then how about if I take this extension instead of Q cyclotomic, suppose I take this kind of extension. I fix a non-CM elliptic curve and I take this big extension. Then can we establish the algebraic functional equation? So these are the kind of question I'm asking. And the second question, so in this case, note that in this case, by well pairing, this big extension contains the cyclotomic, Q cyclotomic extension. By well pairing on elliptic curve, this contains the cyclotomic extension. So if I put H to be Galois group of this over Q cyclotomic, then G mod H is isomorphic to Galois group of Q cyclotomic over Q, which is isomorphic to ZP. So this is one example of a periodic Lie extension which occurs naturally in arithmetic. So let me talk about another, which the so-called false state curve extension. So take M a natural number and P power 3 and take Q and take this extension J infinity, which contains a Q cyclotomic extension. So you fix an integer M, which is P power 3, and you consider this extension. So you attach all the P to the power nth root of infinity. So I'm just saying it as Q mu infinity. And on top of that, you attach the 1 by pth root of M, 1 by P square root of M, and all the 1 by P to the power nth root of N. Then this extension is J infinity I'm denoting by. And then it is easy to see that the Galois group of J infinity over Q is isomorphic to ZP star, semi-direct product ZP. And if I put H is again Galois group of J infinity over Q cyclotomic, then one can see that G mod H is isomorphic to ZP. So this is again some kind of Kumar extension. So again, we can say that this is a natural example where you come across a Galois group, we come across a periodic Lie extension, which is so whose Galois group is a periodic Lie group. And inside this, we have this Q cyclotomic extension. So for example, so these are a prototype of what is called this non-commutative periodic Lie extension. So one can ask over this kind of extension, if I take elliptic curve or if I take a modular form, or if I take a, let's say, nth symmetric product of elliptic curve, Galois representation of elliptic curve, and this kind of motif, if you take, we can ask this question, then does this algebraic functional equation hold? Okay. So for the rest of the talk, I'll answer this question. So again, so what do we have to do? So let me go back one slide. So template is there because of commutative result due to Greenberg and Perandrew that, so we have to have a twisting lemma. So, and we have to have this kind of control theorem, and then we have to have, and then we have the Cassell-Stress pairing, and we need appropriate homological result. So for the cyclotomic extension, the homological result is quite straightforward, but for a bigger extension, it may not be straightforward. So, so this is the goal, to establish algebraic functional equation over other periodic Lie extension and possibly for other motifs. So what are the generalizations which are possible? For example, what about characteristic ideal? So there is this five author paper, which in some sense sets some of the basics about non-commutative Yuasawa theory due to Coates, Fukaya, Kato, Sujata, and Veniakov. So there is a, for example, exact sequence of K groups. So this is K1 of the, so this is Yuasawa algebra of this compact periodic Lie group, something like this. And instead of ZP, we have some ring O. And so O is essentially ZP or a ring of integer of a finite extension of QP. And then we have some kind of non-commutative localization at some certain sets, which are called old sets. And so we have sequence of K group, and this is some kind of Grothendieck group of some category or some kind of relative K group, relative K naught group. So there is some exact sequence of K group, and what they have suggested that one can define a characteristic ideal for appropriate finite integrated torsion module when they make sense here in this K naught group. And of course, they have defined this generalization, and now and when you take G equal to gamma, so the previous case, and H equal to identity. So when you take the commutative case, then you get back the previous definition of characteristic ideal. So in that sense, this is a generalization. So there is a setup of doing this kind of non-commutative Yuasawa theory via this article, and which we follow. So then, So then the first result, which you have established, is a generalization of this twisting lemma. So this is joint with Tadashi Ochiai and Galgeli Zavradi. So what you prove this is take P odd and take G. So this is a purely algebraic result pertaining to generalization of the twisting lemma. So take P odd and G a compact periodically group and H a closed normal subgroup such that G mod H is isomorphic to gamma. So motivation is coming from this kind of thing, but this is a general result. And M be a finitely generated ZPG module such that M mod MP is finitely generated over ZPH. So in particular, this is some kind of generalization of the result that M is torsion over ZPG. So this is slightly stronger condition that M mod MP is not only sort of torsion over ZPG, it is of course over non-commutative ring, we have to talk carefully, but let's say intuitively, so this is stronger than M being torsion over ZPG. So where is this coming? So why is this assumption? So this assumption is coming from this paper. And they call this, so this condition that M mod MP is finitely generated over ZPH such that M is a finitely generated ZPG module, this kind of category of such module, they call the category MHG. This paper quotes Fukaya, Kato, Sujata, and Beniakov. And they believe that all interesting arithmetic modules, including this dual Selmer group, should lie in this category. So this assumption coming with that M mod MP is finitely generated over ZPH, coming with this formulation in mind. Okay, so then there exists a continuous character theta from gamma to ZP star, such that for every open normal subgroup U of G, this M theta U, so largest co-invariant of M theta by U, so or formally H naught homology U M theta is finite. So this is a exact generalization of this. And here, for example, the compact periodic Lie group, we allow it to have a P torsion. We do not allow, assume it is pro P or any such thing. So this is a fairly general result. And somehow this was a basic result in the commutative case, but it was missing in the non-commutative case. So this is a basic result we proved. So this is the analog of the twisting lemma, or this is, we can call this a non-commutative twisting lemma. So once we have the non-commutative twisting lemma, then we can talk about algebraic functional equation. So that is the result I'm going to talk next. So take K be a number field and K infinity over K and admissible periodically extension. So by this, I mean that K infinity over K is a Galois extension and Galois group of K infinity over K is a compact periodically group. And admissible means it is unified outside finitely many primes. So if you look at this extension, it is, this extension, Q of PP infinity, it is unified outside the bad primes of the elliptic curve. If you look at this over Q, then it is unified outside the bad primes of the elliptic curve. And this extension, it is unified outside P and P. And this is unified outside P and primes dividing M. So, and maybe infinite prime. So these are unified outside finitely many places. So we make this assumption, we allow those kind of extension which are unified outside finitely many places. And let this curly K be a finite extension of QP with ring of integers O. And V, so copies of K, be an ordinary periodic Galois representation. So I do not define what it is, but I'll give examples of. So it is just means that V has appropriate filtration as a GP module. It has appropriate filtration. And we take, so once we have this periodic Galois representation, ordinary periodic Galois representation, we choose a GK stable lattice inside this and you define this discrete lattice A equal to V mod T. So this is our analog of, so if it is an elliptic curve, this is just EP infinity. This is like BPE, this is like TPE, and this is like EP infinity. And again, so we have, one can define under this ordinarity condition following Greenberg's method, one can define a Selmer group over each number field and over this kind of periodically extension also. So then this periodically extension cell map group or periodically extension fixed by U, there is a restriction map from this cell map group over KU. So this is K infinity fixed by U to this. So I call this R theta U. This is the natural restriction map. And yeah, so this is the natural restriction map.
Is any open normal here?
Sorry, U is?
U is any open normal subgroup?
Yes, yes, U is any open normal subgroup, yes. Yes. Just a second. Yeah, so this is the natural restriction map. Maybe something was wrong. Oh, what? Just a second. Oh, my slides are not moving.
Just click on the slides with your mouse and then try it again.
Yeah, so. Okay. So maybe I try again. Okay, maybe it's working again. So so you take an open normal subgroup U of G and we consider this natural restriction map. So then, as we explained in the commutative place, we need a consider this kernel. We need to estimate we need to have a control theorem for this map, natural restriction map, and we need to estimate kernel and co-kernel of that. So we have done that, and using that, and this twisting lemma. So using that, we have the algebraic functional equation. So let me explain the statement first, and then later I will go into some detail about the proof. And later, if I have time, I'll also explain the proof of this twisting result also. Okay, so this is a joint work with Tadashi Ochiai. It has appeared this year. So assume that. First of all, assume this technical condition that so-called the Selmer group is in MHG. So this Selmer group divided by its p-torsion point are finitely generated over the Kolmogorov algebra of H. Now we are in this setting. So I must say we are in this setting that maybe I have not defined, but we are in this setting that G is a compact periodic Lie group and H is a closed normal subgroup such that G mod H is isomorphic to gamma, which is ZP. So we are in this setting. So I'll say something when this hypothesis is satisfied, for example. So assume for the moment that the Selmer group is finitely generated over the Iwasawa algebra of H when it is divided by its P primary torsion points. And same thing is true for Selmer group of A and Selmer group of A star one also. Okay, so. Later I'll give example of A and A star. So at the moment it is any periodic Galois representation which satisfies some ordinality condition. So, assume that for every continuous character theta of gamma, this kernel and co-kernel. So this kernel and co-kernel of this restriction maps are finite. The twisted for the twisted Selmer group, the kernel and co-kernel are finite for every twist. So that is one of the assumptions. And the second assumption is that without the twist, the kernel is bounded. Either the kernel is bounded independent of U, and in that case, some technical condition on the growth of the co-kernel, which I do not describe explicitly. And but I'll give some example. Otherwise, if the growth is unbounded, then at least we need that the kernel of the restriction map is a finitely generated ZP module. Okay? And we need also the couple of conditions. One is that class of ZP, so is zero in this K0 of MHG. So as I said here, that in this formulation of non-commutative Iwasawa theory, the characteristic element is defined in some K-naught group. So this is some relative K-naught group or Grothendieck group of some category. So, so for example, the class of ZP, so ZP is an MAG. So we can talk about the class of this trivial module ZP. So that class should be zero if this second condition is there. So this is the prototype of the model. We have the false state curve extension. And this is the prototype of the model like ZL to ZP or division field of an elliptic curve. So this condition is coming, that prototype in mind. And further, some technical condition on growth of the co-kernel, which I do not describe, but I'll give some example. And some hypothesis. So there is this X group. So in the proof of commutative algebraic functional equation, only X1 group came, or just the Iwasawa adjoint, what is so-called Iwasawa adjoint. But here in this kind of functional equation, all the X groups of the Selmer group appear. So X1 appears, X2 appears, and all the higher X group appears. So we need some hypothesis so that this higher X group vanishes. So these hypotheses are given in terms of cohomology of the Selmer group with respect to H. So generally we are talking about as a G module, but some condition with respect to cohomology of the Selmer group with respect to H. So if we give some condition on that, which is there in the paper, then this condition is satisfied. So this is what I am describing sort of the most general, what is the, so this is sort of, well, I did not give detail of all the technical condition, but this is some kind of asking what is the most abstract situation when this functional equation, algebraic functional equation can hold. So then this functional equation holds. And this functional equation is not exactly symmetric. So one side we have Selmer group of A over K infinity. Another side I have, so in case of elliptic curve due to well pairing, A and A star one, so this is a Kummer dual, they are isomorphic, but here in this case, in general A, it need not be isomorphic. So this is the Selmer group of A star one, and then this involution G going to G inverse is there, but there is some error term, okay? So which do not appear in the commutative case, there is some error term coming. And what is this error term? So this error term is related to some Euler factor of the L function at finitely many primes. So I'm going to again give an example of this Euler factor in a explicit case, okay? So this, there is some error term in the functional equation, and it is coming from the, this error term is coming on from the certain Euler factor of the complex L function at finitely many places. So, and also we have shown the compatibility of this algebraic functional equation. So again, I gave initially the motivation from coming from the complex L function, but here also we show the compatibility of the algebraic functional equation and conjectural analytic functional equations. Of course, if you talk about analytic functional equation here, so let me say in a general context, so for example, so this is only through example. So I must say this is only through example. So concrete cases, let's say we take an elliptic curve or we take a modular form and you take this false state curve extension. Then also we do not know the existence of the periodic L function, but we have a conjectural formulation of what should be the interpolation property. So the existence of the periodic L function is conjectural. So this conjectural periodic L function satisfies the conjectural functional equation. And if we believe in that conjectural functional equation, then you show that our algebraic functional equation for a modular form over this false state curve extension is compatible with that. So yeah, so maybe again, I made some error. There's some problem. So now it's gone. So let me give an example. So let J infinity over Q be this false state extension. So this is the Kummer extension, which is adjoined by P to the power nth root of unity, and then fix some integer, let's say P equal to 5, then you adjoin, let's say 3 to the power 1 by nth root of 3, something like that. So the Galois group is ZP semi-direct product ZP essentially. Okay, so this is a Kummer extension of periodic Lie group of dimension 2, and take F a new form, of weight greater equal to 2 and p doesn't not dividing n, and which is p ordinary. So the periodic valuation of the pth Fourier coefficient of f is 0. Then take a critical value. So it's a modulo form of weight k, so it has k minus 1 critical value. So take a critical twist, and inside that take a lattice. So of course modular form is a Galois representation attached to it by Deligne and all. So another, and we take a jth critical twist, and inside that we take a lattice, and you take A to be the discrete lattice given that lattice. So again, this is the analog of EP infinity. So then if again this condition, so this is if the Selmer group modulo its p torsion points, p primary torsion points, and the Selmer group of A star 1, so again they need not be self dual, modulo its p torsion points, suppose if they're finitely generated over OFH, so this MHG condition is satisfied, then in this case we can show that all other conditions are satisfied, then this Selmer group of this modular form satisfies this functional equation of the form Selmer group, dual Selmer group is equal to the dual Selmer group twisted by the involution of A star 1 in this relative K naught group. But again, there is an error term. I'm going to say a bit more about the error term, but when are these conditions are satisfied? So for example, one instance where the, and there are lots of examples of that. If the Selmer group over Q mu infinity, so by result of Kato, we know this is a finitely generated torsion module. And if the mu invariant of this vanishes, so this is a finitely generated ZP module, then we know these two conditions are satisfied. So there are many examples of modular form where this condition is satisfied. So there are plenty of examples where this is the finitely generated ZP module. So if you take any of those, then this condition is also satisfied, and then we get this result. So all the conditions are satisfied, and then you get this algebraic functional equation. Moreover, what is this error term? So this error term, so for example, let me make further specialization. So let me take k equal to trivial. Sorry, this Neven type is trivial. So k is even, and so k is even, and I take the critical twist to be equal to k by 2, central critical twist. Then this error term is given by, so this copies of t minus 1. Okay, so what is, so this is the lattice. So it is the copy of t minus 1. At sum over finitely many primes, and then induce it from, so you take the decomposition subgroup at Q, and for each Q you consider T minus one, then you induce it to lambda G from lambda GQ, and this is sum over finitely many primes. And this, and why it is compatible with the analytic functional equation, and why did I say it is coming from values of the L function at Euler factor, because or if you take any Artin representation eta, then basically there is a way to evaluate this at an Artin representation. And that value of that Artin representation is nothing but the Euler factor of the L function at that Artin representation. So it is the Euler factor of this L function of the modular form twisted by this Artin representation, the qth Euler factor evaluated at q to the power minus k by 2. It is that value, and then divided by the eta star, where eta star is a contragradient representation. So the L function of f twisted by eta star and evaluated at q to the power minus k by 2. It is related to and this finitely many primes p1 union p2. So this evaluation at Artin representation of this is given by this Euler factors. So this error term is coming from this finitely many Euler factors. And what is this set P1 and P2? It is actually the subset of this P0, where P0 is certain primes which divides M. So to divide this J infinity extension, we fixed an integer M. So it is certain primes which are dividing M, which are not equal to P. And such that in the local, over this local fields, completion at those primes, basically there is some point. Or H0 of A fixed by this is not equal to 0. So it is those primes, it is some certain subsets of those primes which are appearing here. So this is the sort of slightly explicit version of our explicit version of our functional equation where for this extension and for the modular form, we explain what are these error terms. And a similar result can be done for the odd symmetric power of VPE over J infinity, for example.
One quick question.
Yeah, please.
I guess the GQ is a finer index in G, is that right?
Yes. Yeah, in this case it is, yes. So, yeah, and so a similar result for the odd symmetric power of an elliptic curve with good ordinary reduction at P can also be done, but even symmetric power we cannot cover in this. Indeed, for like the symmetric square, the usual control theorem fails and there are treatment due to eta, so that is by a different method. So we deal with odd symmetric power, then again we can get some explicit description like this over this extension, and also there are a result over division field extension of an elliptic curve, for example, we have similar results. And I must mention that for elliptic curve and for specific equation, there are also earlier work of Zabradi on this, Gargeli Zabradi on this, but his even for elliptic curve, our proof and his proof is different in the sense what he does, he starts with a functional equation over cyclotomic, which is due to let's say Perandrew or Greenberg, and then he takes limit to go to a so start with an elliptic curve and starts his functional equation over cyclotomic, which can be due to Perandrew or Greenberg, and then he takes limit to go to K infinity extension. Where what we do, we just prove a control theorem and we apply our twisting result. And then we directly go from a number field to the K infinity extension. So it starts with cyclotomic extension and he proceeds, and we start with number field and we just prove control theorem, and essentially the kernel and co-kernel of the control theorem after applying twisting lemma gives us everything. So but there are a couple of results of Zabradi for elliptic curve over this extension and GL2 extension already. Okay, so yeah, so our proofs are different. So as I said, the proof, the main step is control theorem and twisting lemma. So I already described twisting lemma. So I still have 7 more minutes. So maybe I just say what kind of control theorem we have proven. So this so control theorem is a very common tool in Iwasawa theory, and it is almost in many papers in Iwasawa theory, a control theorem is there, a suitable control theorem. And the control theorem we talk about here is again generalization of a control theorem due to Greenberg, which is for an abelian variety and arbitrary periodically extension. And this is a slight generalization of that. And earlier control theorem are also due to OCI, some control theorem is there. And this is sort of mix of this. So just to give a flavor, what kind of control theorem we prove. So assume, for example, that A fixed by GK infinity, so GK infinity fixed point of A is finite. Then kernel of this control theorem is a finite group whose order is independently bounded. And second condition, second case we can do is, for example, the Lie algebra of G. So the G is the Galois group. So the Lie algebra of G is reductive. Then the kernel is finite for every U. And inverse limit of kernel is a finite injected ZP module. Okay, so it's not uniformly bounded, but at least the inverse limit is a finite injected ZP module. What about co-kernel? So co-kernel, so assume that for every prime V dividing P, we need some condition. So every prime V dividing P, this is coming from ordinary filtration. A by B plus A of GK infinity, this is finite. So this is finite if we assume this is finite. And also for V not dividing P, we assume that any open subgroup WV of GKV, the local Galois cohomology group, that V fixed by WV is zero. So this is two condition. And then further, again, if you assume this A GK infinity is finite, then co-kernel is finite for every U. And if I don't want to assume this, then assume that the Lie algebra is again reductive, then co-kernel is also finite. for every U. But this condition, these two conditions can be removed. The first one can be removed. And instead that, if we assume that the decomposition group at prime over P is solvable and some other condition, then also we can do it. So such assumptions are there. The decomposition group is solvable. Then also we can prove this. So everywhere more precise estimate on the growth of the co-kernel is given in the paper. So for example, under this condition, what is the growth? It is different in these two cases. Here also these two cases, the growths are different. So we give more precise estimate on the growth of the co-kernel. And in fact, the proof of our algebraic functional equation after applying the twisting lemma basically comes down from this growth, taking the inverse limit of this kernel and co-kernel. And their growth determines this error term, and we get the proof of the functional equation from there. So in some sense, the proof is very canonical, and in some sense, it is very simple. So I have 3 minutes. So maybe I don't say much about the proof of this control twisting lemma, but So let me just say that the twisting lemma, we prove it first by proving a special case, essentially doing some linear algebra. And then we use fundamental result of Lazard's to reduce it to the case where we can write it in a special form and do the linear algebra. So proof it is in two parts. First is essentially linear algebra, and second part is using fundamental results of Lazard on periodic Lie group to reduce it to the linear algebra structure. So yeah, I have 2 more minutes, but I stop here. Thank you.
Thank you, Salman. There is some internet way of clapping, which let me see. I think I can do it. Yes, this way. Yes, good. Okay, it's very, very nice. A lot going on here, especially near the end. But maybe I'll see if people have any questions they'd like to ask.
I have a question. And I've wondered about this many times. If you have a periodic Lie extension of dimension greater than one, and if you have a finitely generated ZP module, a module that is finitely generated over ZP, I would have hoped, maybe it's not true, I would have hoped that that the characteristic element would be zero. Like imagining it as a pseudo-null module. I mean, in the Abelian case, for periodic Lie extension whose Galois group is ZP to the D, that's certainly true. A finitely generated ZP module would be pseudo-null. Its characteristic idea would be one. It would be trivial. And so, do you have examples? For example, you had the condition that the characteristic element for ZP is zero at some point. Can that fail to be true? I mean, do you have examples where that's not true?
Zabradi itself in one of his papers shows that if you take the false state curve extension, so then class of ZP, the trivial ZP module ZP class is non-zero.
Oh, really?
But for GL2 ZP, it is zero.
For GL2 ZP, it's zero.
Yes.
Is there a characterization? I mean, can you give necessary sufficient conditions?
So you can sort of reduce to using some. How do I say? So the way we see it is we reduce it to some condition on when in ZPH class of FP is zero. And that there are some results of Ardakov and Wesley using some characterization of SER by centralizer. So if something happens to the centralizer, then class of FP is zero in ZPH. And if class of FP is zero in ZPH, then you can say something about class of ZP in ZPG. So
I see. So it's a little bit complicated.
Yeah, so.
One more question though, even going back to the cyclotomic ZP extension, and yes, this would be interesting more generally. In the cyclotomic case, I proved that in some cases that the characteristic ideal behaves in a certain way for the Selmer group and for the Selmer group of the dual representation. But there was a question, I wasn't able to do this. There's a question of whether you actually have a pseudo-isomorphism for the modules. In other words, instead of some statement about the characteristic ideals, you could ask a good question, are the two Selmer groups for capital A and for capital A star with the twist, are they actually pseudo-isomorphic? And you could ask that for the cyclotomic ZP extension, and maybe you could ask that same question in a more general context. I don't know if anyone answered that question. So in other words, in the algebraic setting, instead of talking about a functional equation, you could hopefully talk about some kind of pseudo-isomorphism.
This is the first time I thought about it. I mean, in the sense I heard from you. So we only give like just to Iwasawa adjoint or X1. We give a pseudo-isomorphism to X1 and then X1 and the module has. So from Selmer group, we give a map to pseudo-isomorphism to X1 of the twisted by iota action. So, and the X1 and the module has the, but direct isomorphism to itself, we haven't, I haven't thought about it. It's an interesting question,
Yeah, so even in the cyclotomic CP.
Right, yes, yes.
I don't know if anyone's ever answered that question. Mm-hmm.
I see, that's very interesting,
Yeah, so when I wrote that paper, I wasn't able to actually prove that. And but it seemed like a possible thing.
I see. Okay. Maybe I'll try to think about it. Thank you very much.
Okay.
Okay. Are there any other? Sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead, Rob.
It was an interesting talk. Thanks.
Are there any other comments or questions from anybody?
I have one question.
Sorry, who is that?
Jishnu.
Hi, Jishnu. Yes, go ahead.
Okay, so in the cyclotomic case, you mentioned about some pairing, some Cassell or due to Flack, something like that. Mm-hmm. What happens to that pairing in the for the GL2 case? Like, how do you?
No, so I mean that is already there because when you take, how do I say, fixed by U, it's the same pairing we use. So. How do I say? So that is like the starting point for us also. So in the starting point, so what happens? So in some sense, so I'll just go back to that and tell you. Just 1 second. So once you twist, once the Selmer groups are finite, so the role in some sense of twisting lemma is that you make this thing finite. So once it is finite, this is an isomorphism. Otherwise, on both sides, you have to go quotient by maximal divisible subgroups. So once you have the finiteness, then these two things are isomorphic. So you also start with this. So we start with Ku. Instead of theta n, we start with Ku. So K infinity you fix by U, then you get Ku. So then and you have the twist, and by control theorem and by twist, you get this isomorphism by Flack. And then we take sort of inverse limit over is inverse system of neighborhoods of U and open normal subgroups inverse system. We take this thing and then we apply the other results on control theorem. But the same Flack pairing we use. But the thing is but there is a complication here because this is true for classical Selmer group for elliptic curve. This is like good ordinary. This is the Bloch-Kato Selmer group and the pairing is for Bloch-Kato Selmer group. But we use what is the Greenberg Selmer group. So then you have to estimate the difference between Bloch-Kato and Greenberg-Selmer group because the Flack pairing or Castellet pairing works for Bloch-Kato-Selmer group. But for Brockhart-Selmer group, control theorem is difficult to prove. So we proved for Greenberg-Selmer group, which the control theorem is easier to prove. But then we had to compare Brockhart and Greenberg-Selmer group.
Okay, thank you.
Actually, you know, I had a question about that too. I would think that there should be a theta on one side and a theta inverse on the other side. In other words, to have the Castle Tate pairing, you have to have some kind of Bay pairing. And so I would think, I mean, it seems to me, in other words, E theta on the left and maybe E theta inverse on the right.
Yeah, so this is really, so yeah, I mean, so here is a, yeah, there's a typo here. This is E theta star one, I mean. So,
okay,
TP, so yeah, TP theta star one, yes.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry about that, yeah.